As of this March, all three of my children are now married. I still tease the girls occasionally, telling them they're partly mine. And my son, I still call my bud. My buddy, that's my boy. Now, anyone who sees my kids know they didn't fall from the apple tree of their mother or of me. They are of our flesh. They carry a lot of our mannerisms. Our children carry a lot. They carry our genetics, our personality traits, some of our looks and our flaws. So should they choose, as they continue in this next stage of their life, just to hang on to the ways of their upbringing? No, they chose when they got married to leave us, to cleave, and to start a new family, new personality, new ways to learn and experience and grow alongside their spouses, that they are now taking the old off and creating a new life, a new family, a new heritage. Now, Robin and I will always be part of their heart. They'll always carry our genetics and the influences from physical birth. There will always be things that they knew from birth that are going to try to move in and guide and lead them, but they're actually one flesh now with their spouses. And in the spiritual realm, Ephesians 4, I think, covers that as well. When it begins to speak of our old way of life from birth, that which we just genetically received, the way we were born. But in the spiritual realm, the old way is evil. It's alienated from God. It's dead in sins. And Christians have been chosen by God and have responded to Christ's invitation to become his bride, for him to be our groom, for us to be brought into his family through him and to be made one in him. Therefore, believers are a new creation in Christ. The old's passed away. Everything's become new, and we're to live change, not to hang on to the old. So today, let's look at what that means in another doctrinal section of Ephesians 4, 17 through 24, as he pulls in a look again of what we were and then contrasts that so he can say, now, here's what we're instructing you to be in this. If you haven't been in Ephesians, you go back and listen to that, Facebook, YouTube, or on our website. But we're in Ephesians 4. I want you to look at verses 17 through 24 with me, and we'll begin going through this. Therefore, I say this, and I testify in the Lord, you should no longer live as the Gentiles live, in the futility of their thoughts. They're darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them and because of the hardness of their hearts. They became callous and gave themselves over to promiscuity for the practice of every kind of impurity with a desire for more and more. But that's not how you came to know Christ, assuming you heard about him and were taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, to take off your former way of life, the old self that's corrupted by deceitful desires, to be renewed in the spirit of your minds and to put on the new self, the one created according to God's likeness in righteousness and purity of the truth. I want you to see the first major truth that we're to learn that's found in your outline. Notice that first point: identify and refuse life outside of Christ. Notice the therefore or so I say in verse 17. Paul says, therefore, or so I say this, and testify in the Lord, you should no longer live as the Gentiles live in the futility of their thoughts. When it says therefore, it's always referring back. What does it refer back to? We've talked about the fact that we are literally to live our lives in a manner that's worthy of the incredible calling that has been extended to us. We're to live according to the beauty of the unity we find together and according to the gifts God's given people to train us through the church to follow him. So look at that next point. Believers should contrast their lifestyle and conduct with those who are unbelievers and alienated from the life of God. Now, Gentiles here is a term for unbelievers, which it just naturally includes every ethnic group in the world who are not believers in Christ Jesus. And like today, the church composed of the new creation of believing Jews and Gentiles is surrounded. We're vastly outnumbered by an ethnic world of every culture everywhere that has predominantly rejected Jesus Christ. So Paul says to no longer live as the majority of the world lives. Don't live like the majority of cultures live. And Ephesus was a vile city. It was a perverted city. It was a modern-day San Francisco or New York or Las Vegas. It was a modern-day Austin or Wichita Falls. It was a lost world living much differently than what Paul says Christ expects of us to live in a proper manner and to unite together as believers to do and be trained to do. Look at the next point. Unlike enlightened believers' minds, unbelievers live with a spiritual emptiness in their minds, which are morally dark and clouded to spiritual truth, godly values, and right choices. Verse 18 again, look at that. They are darkened, unbelievers, in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them and because of the hardness of their hearts. The word darkened here is in a passive voice. And thus, it refers to something that kind of gradual, passively happens. It just slowly takes over. If you watched people and said they've just gradually sunk deeper and deeper and deeper into their sin, it's a word that could mean clouded. That their whole minds have just slowly become clouded to understanding and those things in God. Now, throughout the New Testament, I like to make this point with us fairly often. The mind and understanding is emphasized in the New Testament. Truth is compared to ignorance in the New Testament. Learning and teaching are heavily emphasized in the New Testament. These all relate to the area of the intellect. Biblical Christianity does not, never has, and never should emphasize feelings over facts and intellect. It's a thinking man's religion. When somebody says, y'all are just, you just caught up in your grandma's old way of thinking. And I had a college professor who'd say that. Your grandma's little warm cookie, churchy thinking has clouded your mind. In reality, the Bible says, no, a thinking man should produce through this, and a lost man has no capacity to think. It doesn't matter how well he argues or debates. It's ignorance in the eyes of God because he has an inability, literally, to understand even the simple truths. You watch TV and you say, how can people do that if they lost their minds? Yeah, they don't have an ability to think properly because they're not in Christ Jesus, and things that are secondary to us are not to them. Look at the true condition of unbelievers that Christians are to acknowledge. Look on the screen. Look at some of the phrases. They're excluded. He said, you were, and they are excluded from the life of God, and then because of the ignorance that is in them and because of the hardness of their hearts. Something very, very interesting is that criminologists will tell you that criminals are not, now listen to this, criminals are not the products of bad environments and relationships. Think about this with me. The darkest criminals come from both privileged homes and unprivileged homes. The darkest criminals can grow up in unloving relationships or very loving relationships. The darkest criminals can have a very low intelligence, or they can be highly, highly intelligent. Criminals can be both genders. Criminals can be every race. Listen to this quote from a pair of criminologists who have one of the noted books. They said, quote, "It's not the environment that turns a man into a criminal. It's a series of choices that he makes starting at an early age," end quote. Listen, sin flows out of our fallen, out of our depraved minds. It comes easy. We need the gift of salvation, which is free. We need to learn to walk, to grow in Jesus. We need a transformation to take place. It's easy. We're born depraved. Look at some other passages that talk about those who are not in Christ and their inability to learn. Look on the screen at 2 Timothy 3:7. "The ungodly may be always learning, but they're never able to come to the knowledge of the truth." Look what Colossians 1:21 says. "Once you, Christians, you were alienated and hostile in your minds, expressed in your evil actions." Look what 1 Peter 1:14 and 15 says. "As obedient children, do not be conformed to the desires of your former ignorance. But as the one who called you is holy, you also are to be holy in all your conduct. For it is written, 'Be holy because I am holy.'" So when people reject Christ, they're clouded in their thinking and choices. They're dull to spiritual truths, and that clouding begins to build, and it begins to alienate them from truth and God's wisdom, and their character then begins to turn over to a depravity and a hardened heart because of that. Well, as if we're not already squirming a little bit, look what Paul then says in verse 19. "They became callous and gave themselves over to promiscuity for the practice of every kind of impurity with a desire for more and more." Look at the next point in your outline. Having identified the character of humanity apart from salvation, Paul demonstrates such character produces a calloused, immoral lifestyle. It is frightening to see this in sex trafficking. You can see this character that turns over calloused and immoral lifestyle through gangs and violence and discrimination, unwed pregnancies, deaths by alcohol and drugs, child abuse, and on and on and on. Look when God unveils about this to us on the screen. In 19a, he says, basically, there's no longer any shame due to the moral apathy that's just clouded their ability to think properly. Think how easily the world just embraces. And listen, Christians can be born again in God and not keep learning Christ. Paul's saying, don't live like you did, which means that Christians can fall in and live that same old way that we did instead of continuing to learn Christ and putting off that old and embracing the new. And so that looks like things like listening to filthy music or vile TV, or looking at pornography. It involves graphic violence. The words and pictures that get shared over social media that are just, there's no shame there. Suppose Christians follow and they, even Christians, when they're living the old way, they laugh at someone like Howard Stern, who's a mockery to anything moral and righteous and just, and our culture's made him famous for his filth. We make fun of Christians who we think are too radical or who dress prudishly, or we mock the virgin, think they're the weird ones today. That is the world we came from and has no place, Paul says, in the mind of the new believer. And it's meant to shake us. It should unsettle all of us and make us all go back and say, what do I watch? What do I see? What do I hear? Is it that which is put on that's new? Or am I still drawn to that which I was born into? It'd be like the couple who keeps saying, I want to be with mommy and daddy. I don't want to be in my new family. I'm not ready to grow up. I'm not ready to make changes. It's unnatural. Look at the next part. 19b says, they also embrace sexual lust and actions are then embraced. It becomes a practice. It becomes habitual. And what happens when these kind of appetites take over? They never can be filled. That's why people can be drawn into deeper and deeper and deeper sexual depravity, because apart from Christ Jesus, it never fills. It can never fill up. And then look at the next point, verse 19c. Every sort of moral impurity defiles the whole personality. It taints every sphere of life. It absorbs one through greed. It's never enough. People are concerned. Become consumed. Notice how many times Scripture says their stomach or their appetites or their lusts are their gods. They live to fill those in everything they do. Got to have more money, more sex, more promiscuity, more that is built around self. And it's a direct contrast to Christ, who gave himself away as a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. So it's a temptation to love self more than to love others and to love God. And everything our musicians sang this morning, played this morning, that Larry chose, talked about making those choices, choosing righteousness, trust and obey, to follow God. And through that comes his joy and his peace. And it's interesting, as I get older, it's fun to grow up with a best friend. It goes back to age 16, because we grow old together. And we say, you know, the more you give away to God, the less there is to hold on to. The less that you're holding on and struggling and wrestling God over, the happier you are. And then you begin to realize one day that no matter how tired you are, no matter how stretched, no matter how many people need a piece of you, the more you can invest in others, the happier and filled you feel. And so we're to walk in a way that's not like unbelievers. With that in mind, after Paul has shaken us and said, don't be like this. This is naturally who you are. It's the genetics you were given. It's the old nature, the old man, the old self. I wish when we got saved it just went away. But we're not going to be ultimately saved from that old nature until we're glorified in heaven. And he takes that entirely away. Until then, he's left it so that we can choose and go through trials and tribulations. And from the side of Christianity, we can see what sin has caused us and the pain it's caused and what the evil one has done to us. And we can reject that. And then he can reward us based on our trust and obedience. With that in mind, look at the second point and second emphasis of this passage. Seek instruction on renewing our life in Christ. Just as God created and sustains the earth, he says, I can sustain you, but you got to learn how to do that. And you got to seek it. Look at that first point in your outline. Believers not only know Christ, this is what I said this morning when I welcomed you, they not only know Christ through salvation, but continue to learn Christ as we study God's word and we're ministered to by gifted people. Look at verses 20 and 21. That is not how you came to know Christ, assuming you heard about him and you were taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus. There's very emphatic contrast here to how Christians are in contrast to unbelievers in the culture. For the believer, there's no acceptance for the excuse, well, everyone does that. What we're to say is, yes, most of the world is doing that. That's the Gentiles, all the ethnic, the predominant culture, and every ethnic group is predominantly in sin. They're all in sin, and apart from Christ, that's what they do, but not us. And then sometimes when we're tempted with everyone's doing it, not everyone, just most. And we have to tell our kids, everybody does that. No, everybody doesn't. And I always told my kids, there are some evil people in church. The wheat and the tares. Jesus said, you wouldn't know the difference in the field, but I'll settle them out. Scripture says God send in, or there are dark angels disguised as angels of light, and they come in and mix, and their desire is to kill, steal, and destroy. I said, there's a few of those in every church. And you got to be gentle as a dove, wise as a serpent. I said, also, don't ever get discouraged thinking nobody is what I thought they were. There are some people as genuinely spiritual in every aspect of their private life as they are public, I promise you. But I said, most of us are just in the middle. We're working toward that, and hopefully we're growing toward that, and we're learning Christ. So we need to learn about what spiritual truths and circumstances mean. We need to keep learning doctrine. We need to keep learning lessons. Every trial and tribulation, it's okay to fail, but the key is to go back and say, where did I miss you on that, Lord? Because I don't want to fail in that area again. Forgive me and help me to learn from that. Learn by example. Learn by imitating godly people. Pick the godliest people you can be around and follow their faith. Learn through gifted people and the use of spiritual gifts that are around you in the church. Ask questions. I can't imagine raising children today without picking some of the wisest people you could pick to raise kids. And I always, Wanda Lou, raise your hand over there. There's sweet Wanda Lou. We asked Wanda Lou lots of questions because she made a lot of right choices in her home, and we learned a lot. We asked a lot of questions from the cowards and a lot more of you that we just, how do we do this? What's the best way to do these things? And so look at the next point. Believers are to take off, or literally you can lay aside the former way of life, the old drives in our flesh that controlled us before salvation. Look at verse 22. To take off your former way of life, the old self that's corrupted by deceitful desires. We have seen how and where those dark thoughts and battles for our minds come from. It's our old self. So we need to recognize, I tell people, all of us are bipolar in Christ. All of us are a Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde in Christ. You can't be healthy spiritually until you recognize the old voice. You need to hear the battle. The beautiful girl walks by for me, and I have one voice that says, look on. And I have another voice that says, treat her like a younger sister with all respect. Train my eyes. If you watch me and my best friend walk down the road and a really beautiful angelic thing walks by, you will see us every time look at each other and smile. That's a way of saying, look somewhere else. Don't entertain the old flesh. Don't go the old direction. Set it aside just as there's truth, and Jesus would have put that old off, recognize it. When you're arguing with the spouse, you'll hear the old side and you'll hear the new side. If you listen, choose the old side says, I tell you what, I'm going to tell you exactly what I think. The new side says, I love you, what are you needing? When the old side says, just take them out, the new side says, turn the other cheek, walk away. Soft word turns away wrath. There's always this battle, and you have to hear both voices before you can put off the old and choose the new and recognize there's two different inside battles that are taking place within us. And so we do that either, and people who don't hear the two voices have either never been saved or they're Christians who have become so carnal that they've continued to live in their old way without living to impress and out of a blessed condition they are of their Father in the new way. Look at the next point. Believers are continually being renewed by the Holy Spirit, which should be embraced in our minds through renewed thinking and choices. Verse 23, to be renewed in the spirit of your minds. It's in the present tense, meaning there's a continual renewal of the mind that has to take place. And the word spirit here is debated. It can mean the Holy Spirit or it can mean the human spirit, but we never see anywhere else in the Bible where it says the Holy Spirit of your mind. And so God gives a human spirit to us at birth and it returns to God at death. Leaves the body and goes to be with God. It's idle in humanity until salvation, and then the Holy Spirit quickens it in order to convert the soul. So humans have a spirit. Animals do not have a spirit. And the idea here is that the Holy Spirit quickens the spirit of Christians, continually renewing our minds. if we're open and seeking and learning and trusting and obey. It should be, if obeyed, transformational for us daily as we grow in Christ. And then the last thing I want you to see is Christ made us a new self at salvation. We're to put on the new self in contrast to the old self, living with purity and righteousness in our thinking and actions. Verse 24. And to put on the new self, the one created according to God's likeness, in righteousness and purity of the truth. For believers, our new self's been created after God's likeness, His very likeness. His entire goal in our lives is to conform us to the image of Christ and to make us more and more like Jesus Christ in holiness and righteousness. Our righteousness should look different than the world's standard of righteousness. So what do we do this morning? If you're here and you're an unbeliever, there's only two ways you can respond to this. You can take offense and say, how dare someone describe me in that condition? I didn't describe you in that condition. I need you to understand I'm just a messenger boy. I didn't make up the phrases. I didn't write the scriptures. I just teach them as faithfully and as closely as I know how. God described and made it very clear that those of us here in Christ were formerly that way, and those without Christ are that way. And so you can either bow up and grow angry and reject that, or it can humble you this morning. You can say, I want to be a part of Christ. I want to be born again. I want to become a new creation. Those old things pass away. I want a new nature that helps me to live in obedience and trust of God and to start knowing. I want to know Jesus and start learning and growing in Him and experiencing the peace and joy that is ours. And to do that, at the end, we'll have leaders standing at either side here by these centers on the side. And you can just slide over there and speak to any of them standing there. It'll be a staff member or one of our overseers. And you can talk to them. And salvation is as simple as a prayer of saying, Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know that what I heard this morning describes me. That is who I am. I want to be born again. I want to accept your free gift of salvation and accept that Jesus shed his blood on the cross to pay the debt of my sin. Will you receive me? I believe. And if you believe, you shall be saved. For Christians, what does it mean for us? It means we've got to put off and put on. My son-in-laws don't want Robin as their wife. They want their wives. And my daughter-in-law doesn't want me in her family as her husband. She wants her husband, Micaiah. And Jesus Christ doesn't want a blemished bride who hangs on to the old and is not willing to let that go to walk in newness of Him and to walk in a manner worthy of being called the bride of Jesus Christ. He gave everything. He was tempted in all ways as us, yet without sin. He experienced our trials, our tribulations, our losses, our failures. To the degree you and I hurt and go through pain in this world, we'll never remotely get it like Jesus experienced it. God put a hedge around us. Satan can only attack us to a degree that God lowers that hedge, and he may lower it pretty low for a while, and things may get pretty dark, but eventually he'll say, I'm bringing it back up, Satan, your time's enough. Be gone. And he'll bring you out of that trial or that tribulation or that time of Satan's attacks. But for Jesus, he lowered it entirely. And Jesus carried the weight of every sin that every human has ever done on the cross, crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? So if he were to do that, shouldn't we want to go through life like he did, saying, Father, not my will, but yours be done. I love you so much. And if we've not seen through Ephesians, my goodness, it's a life-changing book, isn't it? How blessed we are. Just to be called a saint means we're the special ones, the unique ones, the set-apart ones, the holy ones. We're unique, and it's a beautiful, beautiful thing we have and a beautiful way to live. You'll never regret it. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and to stand, please. And as you stand, the music's going to begin playing. We're going to give you a little time. Maybe you want to slip out to the side and go see and talk to someone there at the side about a need you have. Take a few minutes and pray. Ask God how He would have you to respond, to give you the strength to respond through the Spirit of God. And then I'll close our service in just a minute with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we have been learning for weeks and weeks and weeks that You predestined us, You chose us, even before the foundation of the world, to become sons and daughters, to be made righteous, to be forgiven of our sins, to be set apart, to be unique ones. Satan whispers that we're alone and we're cast aside and we're outsiders, but You've made it very clear that we have a very special place, and I pray that You'd help us to live that way. For anyone who has not embraced that yet today, I pray that they'd hear Your free offer of salvation, that they can be saved by grace through faith and not of themselves. It's a gift of Yours. So guide and lead us this morning. Help us to not leave this place being just hearers, but help us to be doers who put on the new and walk in the new daily. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Put off the old, walk in the new. God bless you. Love you. Have a great day.